Who do you think is the greatest ever Scot? Today, I'm going to tell you who I think is the greatest ever Scot, suggest a walking route through Edinburgh, and give you one truly astonishing fact. And if that sounds interesting, then this is the video for you.
Hiya, I'm Bruce Fummey from Scotland History Tours. If you're interested in the people, events and places in Scottish history and you want some great ideas about places to visit in Scotland, then subscribe to my YouTube channel and click on the notification bell. That way you'll be notified every time I make a new YouTube video. In the meantime, let me tell you a story.
Way back in the midst of time, I remember a TV programme to decide the greatest ever Scot. Now, there have been other similar TV programmes since, but this was the original. And it wasn't that long after we'd got our first colour telly. Now, I remember when we got our first colour telly, it was for the World Cup in Argentina in 1978. Another key date in Scotland's history. Did you do the same thing that I did when you were a kid? Get a magnifying glass and go right up to the screen to see what it was actually made of. Lots of tiny red, green and blue dots. And the picture was made by mixing different quantities of these three. If you mixed the red and the green, you got yellow. We haven't always known that. Sir Isaac Newton, you've heard of him, eh? He tried to work it out, but he couldn't. Maybe he was colourblind. He wasn't, right? But somebody must have worked out colourblindness as well. Isaac Newton tried, but failed, to explain how light gets from the TV to your eye.
Serves him right for buying a Chinese telly.
Newton was an astounding mind. He was an incredible intellect, but he couldn't do it. But somebody had to. Somebody had to explain it. How do these colours mix? How do we get them? How does the light get from the telly to my eye? How does the signal get from the TV transmitter to the aerial? Of course, now it's up to the satellite and then back down to the satellite dish. But that needs to be explained as well. Years ago, some friends came around to visit and their kids put a magnet up against our telly that we had at that time, right? And from that time until the time that we ditched it, it always had this blur, right? Now, let me tell you, I wanted that explained. Now, what if all these things were explained and the first time they were explained, it was by the same guy? That would be mental.
And what if he was Scottish?
That's not even the astounding fact. Are you coming?
Now, I'm in Edinburgh and I'm going to go on a 3-mile walk and I invite you to go on the same walk when you get a chance. Now, if you look up behind us, there's the castle and the old town. Behind these trees is the church that the greatest ever Scot attended as a child. And up here, up there behind me is Princes Street and the new town. And we're obviously in Princes Street Gardens. It's the lovely, warm, peaceful space that links the old town and the new town in Edinburgh. And we're here to talk about the lovely, quiet, warm, peaceful man that transformed old science to new science and changed the world. He was born in this house on the 13th of June, 1831. It's now run by a trust. You can visit. You can even do a virtual online tour. I'll leave the links below. Now, the fact that he was born in a house in the newly built Georgian new town in Edinburgh tells you that his family were not poor. They were early Victorian minor gentry. They had an estate down in Galloway where our young lad spent his early years. His rural Galloway accent was why the other boys here at his school, Edinburgh Academy, called him Dafty. Now, when he was at Edinburgh Academy, the Professor of Natural Philosophy at Edinburgh University read a new paper to the Royal Society of Edinburgh. Our hero would have loved to have been it there, because it was his paper. The problem was, he was only 14, and he'd written his first scientific paper without the aid of a PlayStation. He had the same problem twice more before he left Edinburgh to go to Cambridge University, because he produced three scientific papers before that time. And now, here at his old school of Edinburgh Academy, there's a building named after him. It's not called Dafty. Now, by the way, that's not even the astonishing fact. The building behind me here is the home of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. That is where Dafty's papers were read. And 150 yards along the road, you'll see the spire is the church where our hero was baptised. And 150 yards further is the statue which commemorates him, here in George Street. I've heard it said that you can tell the character of a population by the statues they put up. And here, the junction of George Street and St Andrew's Square in Edinburgh is a confusing place. When we look down the hill, we see the statue of Walter Scott, the great writer and former president of the Royal Society of Edinburgh. At the end of George Street here behind me, we see the statue of our hero. And in St Andrew's Square, at the top of that pinnacle, the evil Tory peer, Henry Dundas, who tried to maintain slavery and was the last person in Britain to be impeached for financial impropriety. Edinburgh is a wonderful place, but it does have its dark side. That brings us back to the subject of light and the spirit of our hero behind us. The thing that made him famous in his time was that he won a competition. Now, we're not talking about winning a 10 on a scratch card. This was a thing of mathematical genius. It was not luck. Now, by this time, people knew that Saturn had rings, but they had no idea what they were made of. Telescopes just weren't strong enough at that time. And a competition was set with a prize to anyone who could prove whether Saturn's rings were a solid, a liquid, or lots of little lumps of rock. And the competition had been set 2 years before that, but nobody had been able to do it. And this time, in all the world of science and mathematics, there was only one entry. Our guy. He was the first to explain what Saturn's rings were made of. Now he was on the world stage. And that's not even the astounding fact. Now at the time, he was professor of natural philosophy at Marischal College in Aberdeen. He went to live in Aberdeen.
Is that the astounding fact?
No. But it does show how dedicated he was to experimental science. Now, people have had theories about what it's like to live in Aberdeen, but it's always been difficult to prove it. Does it actually suck all the light out of everything, just leaving a pinpoint of darkness and infinite gravity, or does it just appear to? How close to the Ring Road bypass can Aberdeen come without sucking it in? Fundamental questions. Now, our hero met his wife in Aberdeen. And even though light can't escape from Aberdeen, our hero and his wife did. They moved to London when he became professor at King's College. Now, if Saturn's rings made him famous in his time, then the first time I heard about him was when I was studying electricity and magnetism. Now, he worked on this over a number of years, doing hard graft with eureka moments of inspiration along the way. But I want to tell you one lovely wee story on that journey. Here's four facts. Don't worry, even if you think you know nothing about science, you already know at least two of them. Fact number one, magnetic poles always come in pairs, north and south. Opposite poles attract, similar poles repel. Told you. Fact two, electric charge also comes in two types, opposites attract, similar repel. Fact three, if you've got an electric current passing through a wire, like the one from your phone to your charger, it creates a magnetic field around about the wire. Here's an easy science experiment. You could check this for yourself with taking a wee plotting compass, any DC current. Why not buy plotting compasses for your grandkids? I know my demographic. They can check this out while we experiment for themselves. I'll leave a link in the description below. Fact 4. If the electric current varies, then the magnetic field will vary. Now, if you understand this, let me know in the comment section below. Yes or no is enough. Now, people knew these facts. Michael Faraday had done experimental work to come up with an electric motor. Our hero set out to come up with a single, concise set of rules to explain them all at once. This would be more fundamental than Saturn's rings. It would be like Newton's breakthrough in gravity, maybe even bigger. Yeah? Now, while he was working in London, he'd come up with three explanations for three of the four phenomena. He just couldn't come up with a fourth to explain and bring together and unify the whole theory. And it had to match, it had to fit in with existing ideas. Now, he went home to his estate in Galloway for the summer. Now, when he went, he didn't take any books, tables, documents or figures. He was there to deal with his estate, to be a laird. Now, in the peace and tranquility of rural Galloway, something struck him. He suddenly had an idea that would explain the fourth phenomenon. And it matched with the explanations for the first three. Now, somebody must have had a fag packet, because he did some quick maths and it worked. This was unbelievable, right? Now, at this stage, it was just a model, yeah? But it explained the magnetic attraction and repulsion, it explained the electrical attraction and repulsion, and the interaction of electricity and magnetism in one complete model. Oh, not only that, but a key relationship between electric and magnetic fields came out with a number very close to one that he knew. It was the number for the speed of light. If this was true, then light itself, that Isaac Newton thought was tiny particles, must actually be the interaction of electrical and magnetic fields travelling through space. This was huge. The only problem was that he hadn't brought the books and reference material that would allow him to find out the experimental work that had already been done to check the numbers and the data. How could he find out? There was no internet. There was no telegraph. There was no telephone. He couldn't jump on an aeroplane, because all these things would depend on theories that he would develop. He had to sit in rural Galloway through a Victorian horseback summer, the only person in the world that understood what light actually was. Can you imagine? How mental would that be? You can't tell the postie. What's he going to do with that information? You can't blather excitedly to one of the estate workers. They never understood why you needed 1.21 gigawatts through the flux capacitor in the first place. Even when you get back to London after the summer, the other physicists don't understand it. I'm talking about the theory, not time travel. If only he had invented time travel, because he'll be dead by the time a German called Hertz first demonstrates and an Italian called Marconi first commercialises these ideas that he's come up with. Now, you've heard both these names, of course you have, and rightly so. But they benefited from the unification of the entirety of electricity and magnetism into four concise equations that describe electromagnetic radiation. That's right! Maxwell's equations. But most Scots have never heard of James Clerk Maxwell. And that is the astounding fact. The man who possibly was the world's greatest scientist ever, and certainly was the greatest scientist of the 19th century, was Scottish. And nobody in here cares, because he never played James Bond. Did he write poetry? Yes. Did he play the guitar? Yes. Did he completely change the way that we think about science? Ah, he did. Prince's Street Gardens here is where Edinburgh Old Town ends and the new town begins. James Clerk Maxwell is where one scientific epoch ended and another began. Who said that? Albert Einstein.
Albert Einstein. James Clerk Maxwell was where maths and physics come together in a way that they never had done before. Thank you, James Clerk Maxwell. Now we understand the telly The one that we started with, right? We understand colour mixing, how it works. We understand how the signal's transmitted in electromagnetic waves through space. The way that light reaches us from the telly in those same electromagnetic waves. Thank you, James Clerk Maxwell. The first colour photograph. Thank you, James Clerk Maxwell. X-ray machines and radiotherapy. Thank you, James Clerk Maxwell. Control systems in aeroplanes, microwave ovens. Thank you, James Clerk Maxwell. Our understanding of how the speed that an aroma-carrying particle diffuses through the air in a room. Thank you, James Clerk Maxwell. I can finally fart with confidence. Now, after he'd done all this, he went on to set up the Cavendish Laboratories at Cambridge, where they discovered the electron, where they discovered the neutron, where Rutherford discovered the structure of the atom, and where Crick and Watson discovered DNA. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, James Clerk Maxwell. Now, I haven't even started to tell you about what a wonderful, warm, generous human being he was. I did say he was Scottish, didn't I? You can read all about him in this book, The Man Who Changed Everything, and he did. I'll leave a link in the description below. I'll also leave a link to an interesting BBC programme. Make sure you've got a licence. I'll leave a link to the James Clerk Maxwell Foundation, who run, you know, the museum in the house that he was born in, okay, in India Street, the one that I showed you. I'll leave you a link to the map for the walk that I took round about Edinburgh. It's got more Maxwellian points of interest than I actually stopped at. But the point is, it's nice. You pass through Edinburgh, Newtown, Princes Street, Gardens, through the old town, up to the old college at the University of Edinburgh, where he first studied as a child. Yes. A child. Now, I hope you've enjoyed this video. Please give it a thumbs up and share. Subscribe to my YouTube channel and share. And listen, it's not for me. It's to spread the word about the man that I voted for as the greatest ever Scot. Because every Scot should know the name of James Clerk Maxwell. Hamendoch is going to be Lama alive. Cheery and Rasta.